Okay, and so how may I help you, John?
Actually, doctor, my wife is concerned about me because yesterday I was having some pain in my chest. So she thought I should be seeing a doctor.
Yeah, you have a very caring wife, and you have correctly come to us, and we will make sure that this is not something. We will see, and we can give you some treatment for that. Okay. Can you tell me more about your chest pain, please?
What you want to know, doctor?
So, can you tell me where is the chest pain?
It is on the left side of my chest, doctor.
And is it going anywhere, like neck or arm?
Yeah, like I had, I, we were watching TV yesterday, doctor, and I had the chest pain. It was going to my arm, but I got fine. That's why I was not very much bothered by it. But my wife was very concerned and she thought I should see a doctor.
How long did the episode last?
I think 10 and or 15 minutes.
And during that episode, did you feel sweaty?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay, and can you tell me the nature of the pain? Was it dull, sharp?
It was a kind of heavy feeling on my chest.
And is it the first time that happened, or has it occurred in the past as well?
No, doctor, it's not the first time. Actually, previously, when I was going for a walk, at that time, on some instance, I had chest pain. But when I was resting, it usually got better. But this time, I don't know, I was sitting down, so it's surprising for me that I had pain all of a sudden.
You must be definitely worried about it, and I'm glad you have come here so we can assess you. Okay.
Okay.
This chest pain, can you score it for me, please? For one being the lowest and 10 being the highest. How severe?
It was, I think, 7.
That was quite sharp, quite a lot, isn't it? So, did you take any medication for that to relieve?
Yeah, I have the nitrate tablet because of my angina. They gave it to me, so I took it.
And did it help you?
Maybe that's why maybe I got better in 15 minutes.
Oh, that's good. And you are quite careful about that. And you are following the doctor's advice, I guess.
Yeah.
Right, that's good. And did you feel dizzy during the episode?
No.
Any racing of your heart?
No.
Any shortness of breath?
No.
Do you have any swelling in your legs?
No, doctor, I'm fine.
Okay. And if, so when you lie down, do you ever feel short of breath?
No.
Do you wake up in the middle of the night
No.
gasping for air? Okay. All right. And do you have any other known medical conditions? You said angina.
Yeah. I was diagnosed 5 years ago with angina.
And what medications are you on for that?
I am taking nitrite, some tablet, another tablet I am taking. I think it's called aspirin.
Okay.
And I'm
Anything
taking some
else?
medication for blood pressure as well.
Right. And how long do you have the blood pressure?
Same 5 years.
And are you taking some medication for that?
Yes.
Okay. And what is the medication?
I don't know the name, but I
No
think.
issues. I will go through your list
Okay.
from the GP clinic. Okay. And anything else you are taking? Anything like cholesterol for lowering cholesterol or something?
No, doctor.
Okay. And is your blood pressure under control?
Yeah.
Good. That's nice to hear. And regarding your lifestyle, what kind of diet do you take? Is it healthy or kind of has some junk food in it?
No, I'm very conscious about my diet. My wife cooks healthy meals for me.
I'm very glad to hear that. And how was your activity levels?
like I mentioned, I try to go on walk, but sometime I end up having short of breath. So that's why I'm not very active these days.
Oh, I'm really sorry to hear that. We'll make sure that you don't get it in future and you'll be active. Okay. And do you smoke at all?
I used to smoke, but when I was diagnosed with angina, I left smoking.
And how long was that? 5 years ago, you said, right?
Yeah.
Okay, that's great. And do you take any alcohol?
No.
That's great. Apart from this, is there any family history of any medical condition or any heart condition running in the family?
No.
Okay. And what is your job?
2 minutes. Mm-hmm. I'm not right. Working now.
That's okay. So I would like to examine you, Mr. Brown. I would like to do your pulse, blood pressure, temperature, do examine the heart and auscultate the lungs and do an ECG for you if in the GP clinic.
Okay. Yeah, doctor. These are your colleague have done some things here, so you can read them.
Okay. Yeah. So, Mr. Brown, the blood pressure is slightly elevated and your heart rate is also on the higher side and you are having this pain, ongoing pain on and off. So I would like you to be seen by a specialist doctor, the heart specialist, right? Are you with me?
Are you not treating me here?
Well, in the GP clinic, I have very limited resources and I don't want anything. So you are having this angina episodes repeatedly and they are coming quite frequently these days. So I'm worried that this should not turn into something serious. Although the ECG looks very normal at the moment, I want to do some blood tests like troponins. And we can only do them in the accident and emergency when we go there.
No, yeah, doctor, but I don't want to go there.
Oh, why is that?
Because my father died in hospital and I don't like to be in hospital.
I'm really sorry to hear that. But we can hardly do anything over here in the GP clinic and the other hospital is quite far away. And we would like you to be seen immediately in the specialty clinic. And the cardiologist will come and have a look at you.
But doctor, you can do whatever you want to do here. I will not go to hospital. Sorry.
Mr. Brown, we have, as I said, we have limited resources. If anything goes wrong and we are not able to save you here, it can be really life-threatening for you.
Okay. Okay, well, time's up.
Thank you.
So, yes, Dr. What was the name? Dr. Sneha?
Yeah.
Okay, how was it? What do you think you have missed?
I don't remember now.
Okay. And what about your time management?
Yeah, it was a bit slow. I was a bit slow.
Mm-hmm. And what do you think can be omitted here in the data gathering part?
I cannot say. I cannot
okay.
Anything.
Okay, yeah. No problem. Let's ask someone else. So anybody can tell me, although her data gathering was really good and all the questions were very relevant here, but if she would have skipped some of the questions, what can be those questions? Yeah. Dessa.
Mm.
Okay. Well, although I know lifestyle questions are very important when we are dealing with a patient having chest pain because these are the risk factor. But if you think that you have spent a lot of time and you have to cover management as well, Dr. Sneha, so at least try to have 3 minutes. Ideally, it should be 4 minutes for management, but at least 3 minutes for the management. And if you think your data gathering was long, although you were very good in data gathering, you tried to make sure that you are getting it right. You asked me associated symptoms of chest pain and you made sure it is chest pain because of heart, right? But still, if you think that you have spent a lot of time there, just ask few questions or skip data DESA altogether. And if in the management, after you have discussed the things, the relevant things, then you can talk about lifestyle briefly. So after you we have treated this episode, the active problem, we will be talking to you about lifestyle as well. In this way, you can cover your lifestyle and management. Okay. So otherwise, your questions were very up to, like, they were up to mark. You asked me about past medical history. You cannot skip that. You asked me about associated symptoms. You cannot skip that. Right. And DDs, you tried to cover some DDs here. Just you could have asked me about fever and flu-like symptom to rule out pericarditis. Right.
Yeah.
And another DD was PE. So any calf swelling or pain.
Yeah.
Just one question. Would have been enough. Otherwise, you asked me about shortness of breath. So in PE, PE would be having shortness of breath. It cannot be there without it. All right. So yeah, DESA could have been skipped. And in the management, you told the patient that we are suspecting you are having this pain because of some ongoing issue with the heart, right? And so that's why we will be referring this patient to the hospital, A&E. Because why? I will be covering this in a bit as well. Because this patient had chest pain yesterday, and this was this looks like an unstable angina, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Okay. So unstable angina or anastemi, both of them, they should be referred to A&E. And we know about STEMI. STEMI is very clear, so we have to refer it. So unstable angina, yesterday he had episode, so we have to refer him to the A&E so that he don't end up in another heart attack, the serious one.
Yes.
Why do you think it was an unstable angina?
Currently the ECG was normal. There was no STT changes. So
yeah, start from the data gathering.
Yeah, so the pain was radiating to the neck and the arm. So it is classical angina relieved by nitrates. And he has risk factors of high blood pressure and previous history of angina as well. So these are all the risk factors along with the ECG and the findings, blood pressure elevated and heart rate elevated. So that is prone for angina, unstable angina.
Yeah, good, good. And another thing, if we talk about the presenting complaint, okay, only the presenting complaint is clear enough to tell you if it is unstable angina or a stable angina. Why? Somebody give me one thing which will differentiate
related to activity or not?
May I say something?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, to differentiate, actually the stable angina is which is predictable. We know an exercise and an exertion, we will have chest pain. This is stable angina. Unstable angina is unpredictable. It can come in at any time without warning.
Rest. Yeah, at rest. Pain, yeah. I told
These
you.
These are related with the activity.
Activity, yeah, true. So I told you, I was watching TV and pain came all of a sudden. Yeah, so it was chest pain at rest. It was not related to the activity. And then when you can ask about relieving factor and exacerbating factor. So it was almost nothing. So maybe GTN worked or maybe GTN has not worked. So unstable angina would be like that. It can come at any time and pain will be gone all of a sudden as well.
Yeah.
And then maybe patient will end up in STEMI or anastemi as well. So we are not sure about anything, although ECG was normal at the moment. But we are not sure what will happen at next moment. So it is very important. This patient was a high-risk patient. Patient was having previous history of angina. Patient was having hypertension. So it is very important for this patient to be taken care of right now. Okay?
Yes. Yeah.
So if patient resists like this, she doesn't go want to go to the A&E. So what to do in GP clinic?
We will negotiate. It means that we are dealing with the type of patient who is rejecting our treatment, right? He is rejecting our treatment. So we will first of all try to find the cause, the concern, main concern. So I told her that my father died in hospital, so I don't want to go in there. But there was not enough time, so she couldn't cover that part well because there was not enough time. Otherwise, we will try to negotiate with that patient. It is very important. We will use stick and candy approach. Candy means you will be fine when you will go to the hospital, because we will be giving you the treatment right away and tell the treatment that is supposed to be done at hospital. I will cover that in a bit. And stick will be, if you don't go to the hospital, then it can deteriorate and you can end up in MI. Okay. And we want your safety. We want to treat you at the earliest possibility. So it is very important for you to go to the hospital. So we will use this approach here in the management, and you can only use it if you are having at least 3 minutes, so that you can cover the points of the management that you are going to, how you are going to treat this patient in the hospital. It is one domain. Second domain is you have to make the mind of that patient as well, and you have to negotiate with that patient, keeping in mind the reason why he is rejecting that treatment. And you have to give a working solution for him after that. Okay, so if we are discussing this case here, another thing is, we can only do basic tests in GP, like ECG. Troponins we cannot do here. And can we confirm an MI if we are not having troponin results with us?
Was yes, it if it's an ST elevation MI.
Sorry?
If it's an ST elevation MI, only then we can confirm.
Yeah. Even ST depression as well, but unstable angina, ECG is normal at the moment. We don't have troponins, so we don't know if what's going on with the patient.
Yes.
And troponins are very important because, first of all, they will guide us towards the diagnosis. Secondly, if we are talking about quantitative level of troponin, so they are somehow telling us the prognosis of that patient as well. If troponins are very, very, very high, then the prognosis will not be that good. So it is a different story. Don't go into detail. Just try to keep in mind that we need to do troponin for these patients. Anyone who is coming with chest pain, if you are in GP, you cannot do troponins in GP. If you are in hospital, you will order them. It's a special blood test to check heart muscles. You will order it, and then you will be getting a result. Maybe it is awaited, or maybe they will give you the result, whether it is positive or negative.
Doctor, excuse me. So cardiac enzymes are not something usual we can do in the A&E?
We can do in A&E, but we cannot do in GP.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay. And if initial troponin is negative, but patient is having typical chest pain, having all the symptoms of chest pain, then what will happen? What should we do here? Troponin negative, ECG is also normal, but patient is having typical chest pain and that happened yesterday. Then what should we do?
In that case, we will admit the patient and we will do serial ECGs and we will repeat troponin after, I think 6 hours or 4 hours.
Yeah, we will repeat troponins in that case as well. We will not let that patient go if we are thinking about typical chest pain. Okay. So if patient has suspected ACS, then we will be, then he can dial 999. And if patient is coming with ACS to you within past 72 hours, it means in last 3 days, if he has symptoms like this, then we will urgently refer this patient to A&E. Okay. And when we are talking about angina referral, the case we did, which was this one. Okay. Patient was having unstable angina and typical symptoms and history was very clear cut. So we will do immediate referral to A&E. But if there is a twist and patient is coming with known stable angina without progression of the symptom, when patient is giving you the episodes of angina, try to make sure you are trying to find the progression of the disease or not. If there is no progression of the symptom and the episode was similar to the previous episodes, it means that we will be doing the routine referral. Patient is already on medication. Patient is a known case of angina. He had chest pain yesterday, the typical angina chest pain, which got relieved after taking GTN. So we will be referring this patient, but that will be a routine referral. But now if patient is coming, who is showing worsening symptoms of angina? Previously, pain was there and pain was for 10 minutes, but now he's coming and pain was there for 30 minutes or maybe 20 minutes. And he might be having some problem with shortness of breath as well. So breathlessness was there as well. But previously, breathlessness was on moderate to severe exertion. But now he's complaining of breathlessness on mild exertion as well after walking few steps. So, both these things means it is progression. And when you will be asking about sweating and other associated symptoms of chest pain, then you will be also getting to know about the worsening sign and symptom. If this is the case, again, referral. But this referral will be 2-week referral. Because it is a patient is having angina, the stable angina. He is coming with worsening symptoms of angina, but we are not suspecting this patient is having unstable angina. Patient is having previous angina, but now coming with worsening sign and symptom. So we will be doing urgent referral in 2-week time to cardiology OPD. If patient is coming with new onset angina, even if it is stable angina, refer to cardiology OPD in 2-week time. Give him medication, GTN, and if other medication, which are like beta blockers to decrease the heart working, the load on heart, and if patient is hypertensive, we will give the medication according to the patient's condition. But the referral, specialist referral will be in 2-week time. So let me know if it is clear for you so that we can move forward.
Yeah.
Please repeat that, Dr. Korot, again.
Okay. So if it is unstable angina, we discussed the case of unstable angina right now. Or it is NSTEMI. NSTEMI will not be a very much big deal here because it will be visible on ECGs like this. Can somebody see this ECG and tell me where you can find the depressions in which leads?
Second lead.
Inferolateral leads.
Inferior okay. leads?
Inferolateral.
Name the leads, please.
2-3 AVF.
Yeah. AVF. And what about this?
One
AVL.
One V5 speeches.
Yeah. So it is a V6 as well.
Infralateral.
Infralateral. Yeah.
Okay. What about V2?
Yes.
V3? V4 as well. See?
Yes.
So the point I'm trying to make is NSTEMI and STEMI are very clear on ECG. But if we are talking about anginas, then things will be twisted here. Because in angina, if there is typical history of unstable angina, then what will we do? Chest pain was at rest with normal ECG. And ECG is showing unstable angina. ECG is normal. Hello. Then what will we do? If patient is low risk, then we will send him to hospital and we will give aspirin, low molecular weight heparin. But the patient, high risk patient, should be sent to the hospital. Both of these patients, whether it is low risk, whether it is high risk, we need to refer this patient to ANE. Second thing, we will be giving both of these patients aspirin. We will be giving both of these patients low molecular weight heparin. Next thing, and we will be doing troponin as well. So this is common in both of these things. If patient is a high risk and after giving the initial heparin and aspirin, there is not a significant improvement in patient symptoms, then we can go for angioplasty or CABG, depending on the specialist review in 72 hours, in next 3 days, okay? But if patient is low risk, then we cannot do this CABG and we cannot do this angioplasty. But actually, you are not the one who is going to make the decision. It will be your senior or it will be the specialist who will be making your decision. As a junior doctor, you will tell him the management which is going to be done in hospital. Tell him that you are going to refer him to the hospital. They are going to do another test to confirm. They will be going to give him some medication to thin his blood. And after that, if necessary, some time they can do some procedures as well to open the blocked vessels. this is the management you will be telling to this patient while negotiating with him. If we are talking about this case, okay, patient is coming with stable angina. He has already been diagnosed with angina few months back, few years back, regular with medication. He came today for maybe a follow-up, or yesterday he had typical angina pain, which was similar to his previous episodes. Then what we will do? Routine referral. If patient is coming, patient is a known case of angina. Now he is coming with worsening symptoms. There is clear-cut progression of symptoms. We will be referring this patient in 2 week time to cardiologist. Patient is coming with new onset on angina, chest pain, angina related chest pain for the first time. We will be treating this patient at the moment. We will be giving him the treatment at the moment, and we will be referring this patient as well in 2 week time to the specialist. Is it clear now?
Yes.
Yes, doctor. Thank you.
Okay. So we have discussed this. So if it is STEMI, then things are very straightforward.
Patient. Sorry, عمرو, فيش وقت. شتى تخش. شتى تخش عليك دور. يلا خلص بسرعة.
Sorry, can you mute yourself? Somebody is talking.
يلا خلص صلاة. خلص صلاة دخله.
Dr. Ahmed, please mute your mic, doctor.
Okay. So when we are talking about STEMI, if symptoms have started within past 12 hours, then what will you, if you are in GP, then what will you do? You will refer this patient straight away for PCI. If symptoms have started beyond 12 hours, then still you will be referring this patient, but then the treatment option will be dependent on the, you know, specialist. They will consider whether they need to do PCI or they need to do CABG. So they will bypass surgery, okay? So consultant will be thinking about the options, but as a GP, what you will do, you will refer this patient. STEMI, refer. And STEMI and unstable angina, refer to A&E at the moment. And when you will be talking about the treatment, then you can tell the patient within 12 hour, patient is referred for PCI. If symptoms started within 12 hour, but patient cannot receive PCI, the nearest hospital is not having that facility, then we can go for thrombolysis, okay? Lt-place, streptokinase, these kind of things. But preferably PCI not available, then we can go for thrombolysis. But if symptoms started more than 12 hours ago, we will refer, but the best procedure will be decided by the specialist. They will do angiography, and then depending on the vessel condition, if there is more blocked vessel after angiography, then they can do bypass surgery. If there are not much blockage in the heart, then they can go for PCI. So the specialist will be thinking about the options, and you can tell both of these options. Is it clear now? Any question?
Hi, Doc. Just a quick question. The case that we just discussed about Mr. Brown, was it immediate referral or a routine referral?
Immediate referral, because that patient was having unstable angina. That was yesterday. So we have discussed that within 3 days, 72 hours, patient had pain, unstable angina. So what will you do? You will refer this patient.
Oh, yeah. Immediately. Yeah. All right. Got it.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
Hello. If we find that the patient is having ST elevation MI on telephonic call, so we will arrange some ambulance for the patient as well.
Yeah, you can ask him if he can go to the hospital or not. If he cannot, you can send the ambulance right away. If hospital is very close to his home, then he might go to the hospital by himself. So you can ask him.
For example, if the patient is like old patient, like this case, and even he says that yes, I can go, but still, isn't it risky to send him send the patient with MI to the hospital alone?
Actually, he cannot drive. Good point. So if there is anyone who can take him to the hospital, If no, then send an ambulance for him right away.
All right. Thank you.
Dr. Kurat, just one question here.
Yeah. Yeah.
The reason, you know, why it is my personal choice that, you know, I would go for ambulance because, you know, sometimes, you know, ambulance can, you know, even though it's however near, you know, ambulance can, you know, go through the signals as well, you know, and signals actually, I mean, normal if you drive, then, you know, it, I mean, you cannot break the signals actually. And sometimes, you know, like MI patients, you know, they are very, they can die within minutes as well, you know, sometimes.
Yeah.
So, I mean, just, you know, looking at that perspective, I think that, you know, I would go for second option, like, you know, call the ambulance straight away.
Yeah. You can go for this option, but maybe patient is living within 5 minute drive from hospital. Then ambulance will take some time. Okay. You will arrange ambulance, then ambulance will go to that person home. So if he's living 5 minute away from hospital, then he can go away, go there right away.
That's right. Yeah. Okay.
But ambulance will be your priority. Specifically, you are dealing with a hemodynamically unstable patient, and specifically STEMI and STEMI, then obviously. But the patient that we did, he was having unstable angina. He was not having chest pain right now. So if he says he can go to the hospital on his own, then it's okay. He can go. But yeah, it varies from case to case.
Absolutely, yeah. So if it would be this case, you know, this is still good. But if MI, then, you know, probably I'd go for that.
Yeah, and also somebody else should be driving for this patient with chest pain. The patient is having chest pain. He can collapse.
So if patient is at home and we are doing a telephonic consultation, so in management, then we are not going to mention all these things that we should give aspirin and something of that sort.
Actually, we will be telling this patient, if patient is at home, then we will be telling this patient what management will be done in the hospital. No, don't go in details, but still tell him that when you will go to the hospital, they will do this, 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 because you will be marked for your management. What management you know as a junior doctor for this patient?
Yeah, that I was thinking about. Okay, thank you.
Okay, you are welcome. This meeting is going to finish in less than 1 minute. I'm giving you the next link so that we can do the other station. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
One more question, ma'am.
Yeah. Next meeting, okay? Ask in next meeting.